In this video, we're going to be taking a look at estimating mu when sigma is known. Basically, as we go throughout the chapter on estimation, we'll be looking at different kinds of intervals we could create. And if we want to estimate mu when sigma is known, we're trying to estimate the population mean when we know the population standard deviation, right? Sigma stands for population standard deviation. And what I can tell you is that this scenario doesn't come up all that often. It is very rarely the case that you would know the population standard deviation, but you would not know the population mean. Okay, that's not a very likely scenario. It does happen occasionally, usually when you have a previous study that has provided an estimate of the population standard deviation, and you're building upon that research to do a new estimate of mu. But for the most part, this isn't a very likely scenario. The more likely scenario is that you're going to be estimating mu and sigma is unknown, but that has a different methodology, and we'll take a look at that too. But starting here, estimating mu when sigma is unknown. Couple of things that you need to know. The most crucial is the conditions for inference. Because estimating mu when sigma is known rests on the sampling distribution for x bar, which is by the central limit theorem, that's a normal distribution, we have to meet some conditions for inference here that are based on the conditions from the central limit theorem. Couple of things that have to be satisfied in order to estimate mu when sigma is known. First of all, we need our data to be obtained via a simple random sample. If there's bias in the sample, this method does not hold. Okay, so we need a valid sampling method. Specifically, we need a simple random sample. Additionally, to use the method we're going to talk about here, sigma has to be known. Right? Otherwise, estimating mu when sigma is known doesn't really work very well if you don't actually know sigma. And then your other conditions are you need to know that x follows a normal distribution. So the variable has to follow a normal distribution, or we need a sample size of greater than or equal to 30, right? That's coming straight out of the central limit theorem. We need to know that x is normally distributed, or we need to have a sample size of greater than or equal to 30, because that's what assures that x bar will follow a normal distribution. And we need to know that because to do the computations for this estimate, we're actually going to be using normal CDF. We're going to be using a function that is predicated on the assumption that you're dealing with normally distributed information. Okay, so that's crucial. You need to check these things every time you do this kind of a problem. If you don't check them, you can end up doing a problem, doing all the computations, but having it not really be appropriate, and your conclusion won't be valid. Okay. So, from here, once you check your conditions for inference and you make sure that they are satisfied, then you've got a couple of options. One option is to compute the confidence interval by hand, and I'll show you how to do that. But then the other way is to do it via the calculator, and that's or a piece of software. That's the more common method. People typically don't do these by hand anymore. They're usually done by some kind of technology. So we'll look at the by hand computation first. And so again, let's think about home selling prices in Bellingham. And so we had a sample of size 50, our x bar was 320 1,000, and let's say that I knew the population standard deviation was, oh, let's say 15,000. Let's make it 35,000. Let's make it a little more interesting. Okay, so let's say this is the information that I had. I was interested in, we wanted to find, let's say, a 95% confidence interval for the population mean home selling price. Bellingham. What I have here is the sample mean home selling price based on a sample of size 50. But what I want is the population mean of all homes in Bellingham. What is the mean selling price? And here I have taken a random sample. Let's say that this was a simple random sample, so we knew that, of size 50. That sample had a mean selling price of 320,000. And let's say from previous market research, I knew that the population standard deviation of home selling prices was $35,000. Okay, so I can check my conditions for inference first. Is it a simple random sample? Yes, I said it was. Sigma is known, right? Here it is, 35,000. And I have to be told somewhere in the problem either that X follows a normal distribution, or I need a sample size of greater than or equal to 30. And in this case, I didn't have any information about X following a normal distribution, but my sample size is 50. So I'm good to go. I meet all of the conditions for inference. Now, what the by-hand computation helps us do is to determine that margin of error, right? We already know our starting point. It's $320,000. Now I need to figure out what's that little bit of wiggle room, that margin of error that I'm going to add and subtract. So I will show you the formula for doing this. Basically, you're going to take your x bar plus or minus your margin of error. And the formula for margin of error, if you're estimating mu when sigma is known, and you're going to do this by hand, here's the by-hand formula. You take z sub c. This is a critical value of z, and I can tell you where to find it. There's a fly leaf in the very front cover of your textbook that has a table that have common confidence levels and their critical value for z. So basically, your percent confidence is what determines this number. The higher your percent confidence, the larger this number, because again, higher confidence levels result in wider intervals. So this is what controls how wide your interval is. Okay, so z sub c times sigma over the square root of n. And you'll recognize this as the standard deviation of the x bar distribution. Okay, so we're going a certain number of standard deviations away. So this is the number of standard deviations, and this is the value of the standard deviation. So that just tells us how far away to go. What you will sometimes see in alternate notation for this is that mu is between x bar minus z sub c times sigma over root n to x bar plus z sub c times sigma over, root n. And that's saying the same thing. It's just here it's written in plus minus notation. Here it's pointing out that the minus gets you the lower end point of the interval and the plus gets you the upper end point of the interval. So those two notations can be used interchangeably. So let's take a look at what this would look like if we were doing it by hand, and then I'll show you how to do it on the calculator. Okay, so by hand it would look like this. Again, x bar plus or minus z sub c times sigma over root n. Our x bar from our sample was 320,000 plus minus. If you look up your critical value of z in the table, that's associated with 95% confidence, you're looking at a Z sub C of 1.96. Remember, when we're talking about the standard normal distribution, if we want to capture approximately 95% of the data, we need to be 2 standard deviations. The Z-score associated with that is 2. Here's our 1.96, it's approximately 2. Okay, so that's where that's coming from. Our sigma is 35,000 over the square root of our sample size, which was 50. Okay, so there's what it would look like in that condensed form. And then if we crunch that through, 1.96 times 35,000 over the square root of 50, that gives us $9,701.51, roughly. So we're looking at 9701.51 here, and 320,000 plus or minus that. So then if I want to convert this is one way to look at it. 320,000 plus or minus about $9,700. Okay. The other format that you'll see used is actually to take that 320,000 and subtract the 9701.51 to get a low-end estimate of $310,298.49. That's on the low end. And on the high end, we would take the 320,000 and add the $9,701.51 to get $329,701.51. Okay, so that's just another format. You can do it as a plus minus like this, or you can actually take 320 minus this to get the low, 320 plus this to get the high. Both of these are giving the same interval. Okay, so there's our interval. Now what the heck does that mean? Okay. So since this was a 95% confidence interval that we computed, we are 95% confident that this interval is one of the many intervals that actually contains the population mean home selling price. Again, we can't be 100% confident because we could have just gotten a weird sample and this 320 might not be an accurate value, but we should be pretty confident. So to interpret this value, we are 95% confident that the population mean home selling price in Bellingham is between $310,928.49 and $329,701.51. Okay, that's our interpretation. And this is pretty well boilerplate. You can always start with a statement about confidence. That's the first thing that your interpretation piece should have. How confident are you? Then it should talk about what did you actually estimate, right? So here's our confidence level. Here's what it was we estimated. And then the third thing that your interpretation piece should contain is what was your actual interval. So level of confidence, what did you estimate? What were your interval boundary values? Now I'll show you how to do this exact same thing on the calculator so you don't have to do the computation by hand. In your calculator, all of your confidence intervals live in the same place. If you press second and then, don't press second. Press stat, there we go. And go all the way to the right to tests. You want to go to your tests menu. And then you'll scroll down. The first 6 options all end in the word test. But once you get down to option number 7, you'll see they start ending in interval. Those are your confidence intervals. And if we're trying to estimate a single mean mu and sigma is known, that's when we would use the thing called Z interval. This is for estimating mu when sigma is known. So we will select that by pressing enter. Then the calculator will ask you, do you have data or do you have stats? Did they actually give us the list of all of the 50 home prices? That would be data. Or did they give us the summary statistics, the mean, the standard deviation, and so on? And what we were actually given was the summary stats. We don't know all individual home prices, all of the 50. So you'll want to make sure that stats gets selected. Then it'll ask you for your standard deviation. In this case, our standard deviation was 35,000. So we'll put that in. It'll ask you for your X bar from your sample. Our X bar was 320,000. It'll ask you for your sample size. We have a sample size of 50. And then your confidence level, we were doing 0.95. And when you have all of that put in, you calculate. And here, what you'll notice is that they've rounded a little bit. Like we had 310, was that supposed to be 298? And oh, it was. Okay, pardon me. 298. So 310, 298, 49, and 329, 701, 0.51. Here, we just get the rounded versions of those. So 310, 299, they rounded up there. 329,701. Okay. So there's some rounding error there, but basically it's the exact same interval. And that's what you'll find. Sometimes your by hand computations will be a little bit different from the calculator due to rounding. But certainly if you want to use the calculator, it does save a lot of time, especially as we progress through this section. The by hand computation formulas are going to get a lot more complicated. They're going to have a lot more values to put in, and it's so much quicker and easier and usually more accurate to use the calculator.